We would like to thank all of our From the Field sponsors. This project is funded in part by Jody K. Kingdon and Henry S. Kingdon, doctor and PhD, as well as a grant from Sauk County UW Extension Arts and Culture Committee and the Wisconsin Arts Board with funds from the state of Wisconsin. To learn more about sponsoring one of our webinars, please contact Kate Fitzwilliams. We are excited to have you all join us for the third presentation in the Cranes and Community Virtual Art Series. This fall, the International Crane Foundation is hosting a series of 5 webinars showcasing artists with strong ties to Sauk County. The Cranes and Community Virtual Art Series will highlight the work of 5 gifted artists, including Kim Russell, Janet Flynn, Elliott Funmaker Sr., Jay Jocham, and Masako Pellerin. Artists will discuss what inspires them, talk about their artistic process, and share stories. And today we are delighted to have Kim Russell share her presentation, The Long and Winding Roads That Lead to Portraying Cranes. Kim Russell is a graphic artist dedicated to depicting birds and their natural history. She has worked with the International Crane Foundation for many years. She has created artwork for the gift shop and participated in events such as this webinar series to enhance the educational experience of our members and visitors to the International Crane Foundation. Kim puts pen to paper only when she knows her subject intimately. Her research becomes a journey that leads her from one path to another. She has had her work appear in botanical gardens, at national wildlife refuges, the International Crane Foundation, and most recently a new installation of 34 life-sized flying birds at the Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota. Thank you, Kim, for joining us today. And for all of you, my name is Cully Shelton. I'm the Visitor Program Manager. I've been working at the International Crane Foundation for the past 10 years. And I really enjoy spending time here in Sauk County exploring, birding, canoeing, hiking, and picnicking with my family. But Kim, I understand that you didn't grow up in Sauk County.
That's right. I didn't. Don't tell anybody because I feel I really am a Wisconsinite now. But I actually grew up in a suburb south, about 30 miles south of Chicago. You could hardly even call it a suburb. It was really a subdivision. Developer in 1960 had bought up 600 acres of farmland and put in streets and sidewalks and rows of aluminum sided houses. And it was fairly devoid of what we would call nature. We had been there for a while when one day my sister, my youngest sister, looked out the window and started yelling, "Booey, booey!" And we all ran to the window, and there was a robin in the yard. And I must say, I imagine my memory's a little faulty, but we lived there till I was 18, and I don't really remember seeing another bird in that yard. So don't get me wrong, I enjoyed my childhood. I enjoyed biking on those streets and roller skating on the sidewalks and playing hopscotch in the driveway. But I was also an avid reader, and you know what books do, they kind of expand your mind a little bit and make you want to see a little more of the world. This is one book my mom had brought home one day. It's a golden book of birds. And the thing that struck me about this book, I was only 8 or 10 years old. And even though the birds in it were all common Midwestern birds, they looked so exotic to me. And I distinctly remember thinking, I wonder if I'll ever see any of these birds. When I was young, I did join Girl Scouts, and we sang songs and did crafts and I earned my badges. But it wasn't until I was older in Girl Scouts, we were finally able to take a camping trip. And during this camping trip, we took a walk in the woods and I spied a skull there lying in the leaves. I was just enthralled. up until then, I had not seen a wild animal in its habitat. So I picked up the skull and I just felt there was an animal here. There was a real live animal here. I still have that skull. I later discovered that it was a raccoon skull. But that moment had a real impact on me and wanted me to have even more experiences out in nature. Soon after college, well, actually right after high school, my husband and I started dating. And one of the things we liked to do was come up to the southwest corner of Wisconsin. We would picnic and stop at the farm markets and started camping. And we just fell in love with the rolling hills and valleys of Wisconsin. It was so different from where we grew up. Northern Illinois is fairly flat. You just drive on straight roads to the cornfields. Where in Wisconsin, you drive on these winding roads through the hills and valleys, and it just has so much more mystery. You're always wondering what's around the corner and what's around the bend. But where I grew up in Illinois, there really weren't bends or hills to see what was over. So we discovered we're really not flatlanders at heart. And we eventually, well, there was one experience I have to say we had while we were camping up here. One day on the way coming home, and this was a rather momentous thing for us. We were coming home, and on the way home, we crossed the Wisconsin River right here near Spring Green in Sauk County. And we saw canoeists in the river, and they were setting up tents on the sandbars. And, oh, what's that? We didn't know anybody who canoed. We didn't really know anything about it. But that really piqued our interest. So we came home to Illinois, went to the Y, took swimming lessons, bought ourselves a canoe, and boy, talking about opening up a whole new world. That was really marked a change in our lives. The very first trip we took in our canoe after we learned how to paddle, we went on a narrow river, basically in our backyards. It went from one city to another. And everything disappeared. The banks are all overgrown. You can't see any buildings or houses. And as we came down the river, we came across swans. Swans. What are they doing here? I thought swans were just like chickens, domesticated birds that were raised to make ponds look pretty in the parks. And then a little further down the river, there was a great blue heron standing at the side of the banks, just quietly watching us without so much as ruffling its feathers. And there it was, the heron, right out of my golden book. So my world was opening up and I actually were seeing those exotic birds. Eventually, we did move to Sauk County in Wisconsin. We were here about a year, and I got a call one day from a neighbor down the street, and she said, there's a crane in the field across the street. So I got on my bike and I pedaled on down, and there it was, a solitary crane just standing in the field quietly. And that was the first time I saw a crane in Wisconsin. I was barely aware of them, and it took some time before I saw one again. But it's just amazing in such a short amount of period that the crane population was growing in Wisconsin. And I started seeing them in the field across the street from me. And one day I was standing at the edge of the street and the largest group of cranes I had seen yet came right overhead and started dropping down to land in the field. And as they came overhead, they were so close, I could hear the woof, woof, woof of their wings. And as they dropped down, I just felt like I was in a primeval world. And they are a very primitive bird. They've actually found fossils of the sandhill cranes that are over 2 million years old in Florida. So the population continued to grow and continued to grow until now, Spring Green has become a major staging area for the cranes in the fall. And at this time right now, in fact, the picture you're seeing now, I took just a couple of weeks ago, and that's just a small portion of the cranes that were in the field. We'll have 200 to 300 cranes in the field across the street, and another 200 to 300 in the field next to that, and another 200 to 300 on the other side, and 500 in the field behind that. It's just amazing. It's amazing. We've been here just over 30 years, and to see that kind of growth, I never expected that, but to top it off, I had a real experience a few years ago. It was this time of year, and they're staging, and there's hundreds of cranes out, and there's all those little gray dots in the fields, and I noticed a white dot in the middle of the gray. I got out my binoculars, and there was a whooping crane. A whooping crane in the wild, across the street from me. I never, ever expected to experience something like that. The crane hung out for a few weeks with the others. And some days I could actually see it from my kitchen window.
Oh, that's wonderful, Kim. And I think too, for many of our members and those who are joining us on our webinar today, they understand that the sandhill crane is a very common and abundant species found in North America. And as you said, it is so surprising to have seen an endangered crane, the whooping crane, and to know that you could observe that from your kitchen window is just phenomenal and a great success story for the work of all of the partners, including the International Crane Foundation and citizens and artists, to be sure that the habitat is still here for those birds going ahead into the future. And I recognize that as you became more aware of the birds that were in your backyard, like the sandhill crane and the whooping crane, that it obviously influenced your artwork as well.
Yeah, it sure did. So here we're going back. But while we were in Illinois, actually right after college, we started working with wood for ourselves personally. At first, we made things for ourselves and we found we had an aptitude for it. After some time, my husband developed a full line of hardwood kitchen utensils, some of which were high-end, all bird's eye maple, and he also did lathe turning of functional and decorative bowls. On my end, besides helping him, I started a series of animal ornaments. They're flat animal ornaments cut out of hardwood, kind of started with our scrap, actually. Let's do something with this. And it grew into this whole line, as you can see, called Kim's Critter Collection. I sold thousands of those in gift shops across the country. At the same time, though, I've always done sculpture. I've done the sculpture more for a personal creative outlet. I don't worry about selling it. Here's some examples of a bone series I did. You can see that skull did have an influence on me, and I have actually collected more bones and skulls over time. That's a deer skull and deer ribs with still a bird connection. There's a bird's nest inside of the ribs there. My real bread and butter was the, you know, Kim's Critter Collection. And I wanted to expand the ornaments and decided to make some bird ornaments. Natural thing to do. These are my own design. I wanted the wings to be at an angle. So I, you know, do that special. I didn't want to have just, you know, a flat cut out of the bird, one of the wings out. And it's when I first started working with color, with paint. And up until then, all of our work had been just natural hardwoods, you know, finished with oils. And this also marked the beginning of my connection with the Crane Foundation. Of course, I had to make cranes. And at their request, I made sandhill cranes, whooping cranes, the entire African crane collection. And I sold those. Actually, the critter ornaments kind of faded away, And I was selling these bird ornaments through Preserves, National Wildlife Refuges, and Crane Foundation for quite a few years. I ended up, you know, doing dozens of different species. Another thing this opened up for me by making the crane ornaments was at one point, most of the places where I sell at, you know, refuges and preserves, they have a mission of education. So I decided to add tags to the ornaments that had interesting information about the birds, you know, not just cardinals are red. That's when I started into the research. And I researched every bird that I made an ornament of to get to know it and find information about it that piqued my interest. And oh, wow, birds are so fascinating, incredible. I would say that's what really set my commitment to birds. I felt like I can just do this for the rest of my life. And it changed my sculpture also. I started making sculpture of flying birds. This is the first type of sculpture I made where I would carve the body out of wood, add paper mache wings. Now with this form, it is of course very time consuming, and I could only make them quarter to half life size, because that can get kind of fragile with the wings. So when I had my first request for a public installation of the sculpture, I actually switched to a different style where I could have plywood wings, thin plywood wings. And I was a little concerned, you know, that it would look realistic enough, but actually it's really quite effective. One of the first ones I did was for Savannah National Wildlife Refuge. Their visitor center has a tall tower in the entryway, and they asked for 13 life-size birds. And they specifically did ask that they be like bigger versions of the ornaments, because it did fit their budget. Since carving the bodies, of course, is more time consuming, and it makes them, you know, a little heavier. So this was the results, and it worked really well. They wanted the effect of having like a 3D field guidebook. So when people looked up, they can learn how to identify the different birds just as they would when they're looking up at the real birds. So I was really pleased to be a part of that. And actually, since then, I no longer do individual birds. I just for like retail, I only do them for public installations anymore, since they are time consuming. And after this project is when I started my drawings. But I'm going to show my most recent installation. That was just last year. And this is the first time I did one where I incorporated the two methods. I wasn't totally happy with those flat bodies, you know, the skinny little bodies. So I decided to do the bodies full carving, but with the plywood wings. And that's really effective, and it was very satisfying. In this one, I'm really proud of for one reason. At this point, I had been started, you know, I started doing all that research on the birds, research for the ornaments, started it. And by now I had started doing the drawings, which you'll see requires a lot of research. So when I was selected for this installation, they had different artists submit proposals. They approached different artists and asked them to submit proposals. And they told me later that I was selected because of my knowledge of birds. And I was really happy to hear that. I was really proud of that. Just a little sample. When they had sent out the parameters for the project, they wanted to have native woodland birds to native to Minnesota. And they had about a dozen suggested birds. And at the top of the list was pheasant. Pheasant. And so I educated them quite a bit in my proposal and, you know, selected appropriate birds and appropriate placement in relationship to each other. And everyone was really quite thrilled with the results. So I'm real happy. I'm real happy I was selected for that. And I actually told them I'm the one to do it. I just knew I was the one to do it.
They're beautiful. So, yes.
Yeah.
And I was thinking too, Kim, about how much I've learned about birds working with you as well. And it's just wonderful to see and imagine all of what you have to learn about in order to do those drawings. And I know you have some wonderful drawings to share with us here today too.
Yeah, when I started the drawings, a lot of people were surprised. It just started with a request for a drawing for a fundraiser. And I honestly, and that was about 10 years ago, and I honestly had not done a drawing simply for the sake of a drawing since high school. All my drawing had been to design all of the wood items and wood sculpture. And artist friends were surprised when I started displaying these. They said, I didn't know you could draw. I said, well, how do you think I'm making all of these ornaments and sculpture? I said, this was fun. I didn't have to draw the top, bottom, side, you know. And it really was fun. I made that one and it was so fun. I wanted to make more. So over a few years, I started making more. And then I did something I haven't really done before with our business. I like analyzing and, you know, running kind of the business side and what sells. And when I started the drawings, I said, I just want to do this. I felt like everything in my life had been leading to this. So I said, I'm not even going to think about sales. I have no idea how they're going to sell. It's a completely different medium. I have to learn how to, you know, mat and frame. And I realized all of my shops are craft shops. You know, they're not going to carry this. I didn't care. I just delved into it. And luckily they were well received. And so they're doing real well. I'm happy. This is one of the first ones. Technically, it's actually a more recent version. My first one, my first drawing of Duet doesn't look like this. I developed my style over the next few years and added more detail and more shading. So this is the most recent version. But this is depicting a mated pair of cranes. And the way you tell a mated pair is when they give a unison call. You don't tell just by them hanging out with each other. I know because I've done the crane count and they want you to count mated pairs, but they won't let you count it unless you actually see them give a unison call. Of course, I've taken liberty here. I twisted the necks together to show how they are mated. Most of the time they do mate for life. I've been told by researchers they sometimes get divorced. Sorry to share that with you, but this was influenced by some actually stones that I saw, carved stones. My main influences are ancient indigenous cultures, mainly Egyptian tomb paintings, Inuit images, and Pictish stone carvings. Here you have examples of Pictish stone carvings. And that is from my heritage. When my dad died, I took his ashes back to Scotland, as I had promised. And there in the fields, they have these carved stone slabs. They're not all in museums behind glass. They're just, some of them are just out in fields. And those really drew my attention, especially as a carver. But in the images, as I was looking at them there, I could see birds. I could translate these images into birds. The one on the right, on your right, is actually a stone that stands at the cathedral, in the cathedral ruins in Elgin, my dad's hometown. And he had shared with me that he used to play in those ruins. They were a playground for him. And there was a really tall remnant of an arch. It looked like maybe 20 feet tall to me, maybe more. And he would climb that ruins. And if my grandmother heard, she would roll over in her grave. So look at the bottom one, and you can see that one in particular was an influence for the next drawing, Primal Cry. As I mentioned earlier, the sandhill cranes are so ancient, and I wanted to get across a feeling of that ancientness, so that seemed like a good motif for me to use here. In the next image, this is a very familiar image for anyone who has spent any time viewing or around cranes. This is my alarm clock. It was actually my alarm clock this morning because they're out here staging. They make such a raucous noise. And one morning as I was waking up to this, I could see the image of their heads just calling. So I titled it Cacophony. And this has become my signature piece. This piece, more than any other, I get requests for variations on. Even the Crane Foundation wanted a variation to use on a t-shirt. It's been used quite a bit in different forms. In the next drawing, I'm starting to incorporate more of the birds' elements that are important to them. And that's become kind of a mission for me. I finally learned at my age, here's what I say. You've heard of the book, Everything I Needed to Know I Learned in Kindergarten? Well, I don't know what kindergarten this guy went to, but boy, you know, I'm finally like in my 60s learning things that I think are really important. I finally grasped the full importance of why we need native plants and why in particular birds need native plants. So that's become a mission for me to encourage people. If you want to change the world, change your yard. Start digging out some of that imported grass that doesn't support any insects to feed birds and put in native plants. And boy, you'll see real changes. You really will. So in this case, I wanted to depict the sandhill crane's favorite habitat, which is sedge meadows. Then I had to research sedge meadows, what you find in sedge meadows. So I had all these lists of the plants and the animals and the insects, and I would look up each one, and I knew I wanted to stay in a small color palette. Since there's red in the bird's head, I wanted to stay in that range of yellow to red, yellow, orange, red. And so I made my selections based on that. I think we can move on from that one. Yeah. I don't know if I had anything else to say about that one. This is a more recent piece. You can see I still have it here, and I will not be unhappy if I have it here for a long time. It's actually my favorite piece. It's my favorite piece I've made so far. And until now, people could see the other influences. They say, oh, you know, the Egyptian tomb paintings and Inuit. But surprisingly, no one detected the Pictish or Celtic influence until this piece. This one's pretty obvious because you can see in the center there, it has the Trinity knot motif. And so then they got it. But I came by it honestly, since it's part of my heritage. And on this piece below the cranes, I actually call this Trinity rising from the sedge meadow, because you'll notice in the cranes domain drawing, it was a sedge meadow, elements of sedge meadow, but it had no sedge. For the design, I wanted to have a plant that had the orange flowers that fit into my color motif. So I used jewel weed, which is found in sedge meadows. But I wanted to depict sedge. So here it is. Here's the sedge, which I enjoy drawing. I like doing those little grains. And I had a little trouble deciding how to arrange the sedge, because basically it's like a tall, straight grass. It's not grass, but it's like a tall, straight grass. And, you know, I'm trying different designs and patterns and swirling it around, but it just didn't seem true to the sedge. And then it occurred to me that in my research, I often looked at botanical samples. And when they have a tall plant like that, they will fold it to fit into their vials, into their samples. So I used that idea in arranging the sedge in this piece.
Well, Kim, I know too that these drawings give us an idea of the influences that have shaped your work. And I know that most recently you have documented the creation of one of the most recent pieces and are wanting to share with us a little bit more in depth about that process. And I know that it is about the blue crane. And so many of us on the webinar and who are members of the International Crane Foundation, others who are joining us today are familiar with the cranes of North America, the sandhill crane and the whooping crane that we had discussed, but this is another species, and the blue crane is a species that is found in South Africa. They're one of the crane species that has the smallest natural range, given that basically 99% of their population occurs within South Africa. And I know that, Kim, this is one of the inspirations for your most recent work.
Yeah, of course, I want to depict all 15 of the crane species in the world. And so I'm working my way through them to have an 8-card set for the Crane Foundation. And I decided my next one was going to be the blue crane. The blue crane is really special. It's really unique. It looks so different from the other cranes. First of all, there are only two cranes that have no red anywhere in the head area. And that partly allows it to shape its head. Let's see, in the next slide, I think you might see it a little better. But its head is so large. It's got an unusual shape, and it actually can spread its feathers, head feathers out like a cobra. It really has kind of like a cobra shape when it's agitated. This is a good sample of what I was deciding to depict with the crane. I had already researched the crane to make ornaments. And so I had done a lot of the groundwork already and knew about them. And of course I've viewed them and photographed them at the Crane Foundation. The thing that strikes me the most about the blue crane is the head, but also the tertiary feathers. So I wanted you to see this picture of the flying crane, because you can see those long feathers that are hanging out to the sides. Those are the tertiary feathers in the bird's wings. They have the flight feathers or the outer feathers, and they'll be divided into sections like the primaries, the secondaries, and the tertiaries. So those long ones closest to the body are the tertiary feathers. And I wanted you to see this because when the crane is just standing, tertiary feathers will close and cover over the back end. That's true of sandhill cranes too. If you take a good look, they have what's called a bustle, and that's often mistaken for a tail, but it's not. It's the tertiary feathers covering the tail. You can see the tail there are just short, stubby feathers. So when I started drawing the bird, I had this in mind. It was to accentuate the head shape and somewhat exaggerate the tertiary feathers. So this is the first sketch I made. And at first I had the bird looking, you can see off to the left there, but that didn't really show the full shape of the head. So I decided to turn the head so I could really outline the head and give more of a curve to the neck. And I toned down the feathers because I wanted it to have an elegant look, which I do think it is quite an elegant bird. The legs needed to be, you know, thinner and longer. And so here's my final shape. This is drawn actually on tracing paper. So I traced over my original sketch with a pen so I can use that to transfer the outline to my final paper, my final work. My tracing paper is my most valuable tool. You'll see as we go along, I don't have any finished sketches or drawings that you could frame and put on a wall. I draw everything in bits and pieces and then trace just the outlines over to my final paper and go from there. Part of that is because in my drawings, I leave the background blank for a more iconic look. So I can't be doing a lot of, you know, erasing and smudging and covered up with paint. It'll just be there. So here's the crane. It needs something more. I need another element in the drawing. I had in mind that I would have it standing on some kind of border. I did that with a heron where it was standing on a bar of hieroglyphs, and the hieroglyphs were actually things that the heron eats. Also, I had just finished the, I keep in mind also the sedges. Yeah, right here, I can show. The sedges under the sandhill crane, that kind of idea where I have something and it looks like it needs to stand on something. So here comes the really heavy research, since I didn't have to do a lot of heavy research with the crane. And that is, I want it to be true to its heritage, where it lives, its background. And since indigenous cultures, influenced me, I wanted to see what those cultures were, what their, images are, what their artwork is. And in my search, which I think you'll see in the next slide, I found that the area, South Africa is, the cultures of South Africa are predominantly Zulu and the Xhosa, which, side note, now we're going to start taking little side paths. You'll see how my mind goes. So Xhosa is spelled X-O-X-H-O-S-A. And since I knew I'm giving this presentation, I wanted to know how to pronounce that. So I looked it up and I looked at different videos. And basically the X is a clicking sound. It turns out the Xhosa are the people who incorporate clicks in their language. There are, I believe, like three different letters that are pronounced with three different types of clicks. And the X, they say, sounds something like when you're cueing your horse, like. And so you would pronounce the click and then the H, Xhosa, Xhosa, Xhosa. And that was really interesting to delve into. Some of you may know Trevor Noah. He has a really good program, and he is Xhosa. And I found an interview where he's talking about the language and singing the click song. I also watched a video of him visiting his grandmother and his hometown in South Africa. And this is the kind of thing that starts happening when I'm researching. You just go down these little side paths. So do I do the Xhosa click every time? Or does that sound pretentious? It's anglicized to sound like a K, Xhosa. So I'll go ahead and do that because I'm not even totally certain I'm doing the click correctly. So the Xhosa particularly interested me, and both Zulu and Xhosa do beadwork. That seems to be what they're mostly known for. The round piece there is not really a necklace, it's a collar. It's called a collar, and it's still used quite a bit in ceremonies, particularly weddings. It's worn by the men. Women wear beadwork too, but men will wear that to weddings. That's Nelson Mandela, who is also Xhosa, and he's wearing a beaded collar at his nephew's wedding. So I just love that piece in the middle there. And if you look closely, you can see it has kind of little beaded tassels, which I wanted to keep in mind when I'm designing. And the diamond and triangle shapes are very common to both cultures. So, okay, here's the diamond and triangle shapes. Now here's the other thing that led me down the road. I do like to depict the plants that are important in their habitats. So in the area that they're really thriving, Western Cape, that's all agriculture. So I debated, you know, I'm committed to native plants, but they're really thriving in the agriculture. They glean the grains, which is a big crop. And so I thought, okay, I'll go ahead and I'm going to use that in the drawing since it is so important to them and to them thriving right now. So the wheat was easy. Love doing the wheat. And you can see the wheat tops there are kind of reminiscent of the tassels on the collar. And I wanted a flower and I read that they grow sunflowers in South Africa. Sunflowers, I love sunflowers. Oh, I'm going to incorporate sunflowers. So I was playing around with, do I do bigger sunflower in the diamond, smaller sunflower in the triangles? And I'm playing with that and something's nagging at me. I only saw a small reference to them growing sunflowers in Western Cape. And, you know, even though I tried searching more about it, I couldn't find much about the crop. I found nothing about their relationship to cranes. But so what, they grow it and I want to draw a sunflower. I'm going to draw a sunflower. And it kept nagging at me and nagging at me. Well, what if the sunflowers are treated with herbicides that poison the cranes? You know, what if, okay, all right. I have to find out. So I called my buddy, Ann Lacey, at the Crane Foundation. She's the head researcher there. And she's kind of used to me, you know, bugging her with odd questions. So we talked about it a little bit. And of course, she couldn't say too much about that. But she gave me the contact for Christy Craig, who is the South African researcher that works with the Crane Foundation. And had given a from the field presentation, which I watched. You can see that too. And she said, no, sunflowers, I don't see them here. I don't know any relation to cranes, but canola has flowers. Canola, what? So I went into researching that. They grow big, extensive fields of canola in Western Africa that are just gorgeous when they're in bloom. And it draws, at that time of year, it draws, you know, flocks of tourists and visitors just to see the blooming fields. So, okay, that's it. Going with canola flower. That's what I used in the image. So this is actually my final sketch, which as you can see, I don't go into much detail. And that had to be transferred then to my paper, which artists out there like to know materials and such. So I actually use a mat board to draw on. It's nice and stiff. It's a good art board. And the beauty of it is it's the same thing I use for my mats. So, whoa, it's easy to match mats with when you're drawing on the same thing. And it's 100% cotton rag, you know, totally acid free. It's pretty good material to work on, and other artists do that too. So I only transfer the outlines to my final board. There's no point in even transferring any details because they're going to be painted over. This is the painting stage. So I use liquid acrylics, which is really similar to working with watercolors. But I chose the acrylics because they have tend to have pigment right in it. So it's got stronger colors. And especially when I work with a lot of reds, I like that nice strong red. So that's the painting phase. When I do paint, I have to keep in mind that I make the colors lighter than I would if it was going to be a finished painting, and make the shadows darker than I would, because once I ink, that tends to disappear. When you put in the detail, the shading tends to disappear, and the open areas with the detail in it, it gets darker. It gets quite a bit darker. So I always have to keep that in mind and not make my painting like you would normally do a painting. So here's the inking. I've only done, you know, the outlines and painted the outlines, and then any inner detail like I'm doing right now is just done freehand. And I do use rapidograph technical pens. I really enjoy using those. There are other pens other artists use that have more of the felt tip, which is convenient. I use those at first, and they are high quality archival India ink. However, I'm disturbed by having to throw away the pen when it's empty, and after a while it starts losing the flow. So I hesitated using these pens because I thought it was gonna be messy, but it's not. If you wanna do any ink work, boy, just try this. It's really easy to use, and I like it. I like having that good flow when I'm inking.
Well, Kim, I know then from your finished inking that we come to the final actual image. And so here it is for everybody to see your long and winding process to leading to the final production.
Yeah, there it is all together. And it was made intentionally for selling at the Crane Foundation as reproductions and as note cards. And they have them right now for anyone to obtain. So that gives you just even that was kind of a brief idea of all the roads I go down when I am preparing a drawing. And in the result, you know, it might be subtle, but the research not only helps me learn about the birds, it helps me learn about more of the world, more of my place in the world, and how interconnected everything is. This is actually a picture that Cully put up of the, taken at the Crane Foundation, fields in the Crane Foundation. So we're kind of bringing this back home. Of course, the first cranes, blue cranes I saw was at the Crane Foundation. And if you look at this drawing, if you look at this photo, it's very similar to photos that I was looking at in South Africa. So things tend to come back around and it's this interconnectedness that I'd like to get across in my drawings or talking about my drawings and how important it is, how important all these elements are and how important it is for us to nourish and protect them.
Well, Kim, it makes me think too about the larger work of the International Crane Foundation and the connectedness, as you described, that circling back here to Sauk County and to Baraboo, Wisconsin. However, our reach as an international organization extends around the globe. And we are so appreciative of your support of the International Crane Foundation, as well as sharing with all of us today about your inspirations that the cranes have led to your art, and then to the long and winding roads that lead to portraying these cranes and all of the details and the history research that goes into creating the imagery. And we know that, Kim, one way that our members and those who are joining us on our webinar and those who have an opportunity to continue to support the mission of the International Crane Foundation is by purchasing your artwork. And we have some of these items that are currently within our own gift shop and are available on our website. And I wondered, Kim, if you could share with us just a little bit about these images before we move into questions.
So the gift shop has had a good range of pretty much all my crane drawings as small reproductions and note cards. These were made specifically for the Crane Foundation on request, and they have them stocked and ready to go right now.
Well, thank you so much, Kim. And again, thank you for your support of the International Crane Foundation and being a part of our webinar series today with the Cranes and Community Virtual Art Series. We want to transition at this time to questions from our webinar participants. And I'd like to introduce everyone to Pamela Seelman. Pamela is the Director of Marketing Communications at the International Crane Foundation, and she is based at our headquarters in Baraboo, Wisconsin. So Pamela, thank you for joining us and for participating today as our question and answer moderator.
Colleen, definitely my pleasure. Thank you, Kim and Kelly, for this inspirational and insightful webinar. We have some just fantastic questions from our participants. I'll dive right in. Kim, did you major in art?
No, I did not. I was very craftsy when I was younger and made all kinds of things, made my own Christmas cards with dual linoleum block, you know, Christmas cards and a lot of that, sewing, a lot of that, and very active in art. In high school, I was co-president of the art club and never considered for a minute that I would follow any kind of career in art. I was actually an English major.
All right, thank you for that. Many people are asking, one of the photos and the projects you engaged in and shared with us earlier, where is your installation in Minnesota?
So in Minnesota, I love Minnesota, and I was asked by the, I was carrying the Minnesota Landscape Arboretum, had seen my cards at the Crane Foundation and was interested in carrying them. So I made a special visit there, and that is just an incredible place, incredible place. I would encourage anyone to go there and visit. And at the time, I was even starting to work with incorporating plants. And so I got a lot of inspiration from that arboretum. As far as the Rochester, the Mayo Clinic, the buyer or art coordinator had actually seen me at an art fair in the Minneapolis area. And I didn't even know it. You know, I didn't really talk to her. She just grabbed my card. And the thing that surprised me was at the time, I mean, I've completely switched to drawings and all she saw was my drawings. And I asked her later, what made you think to, you know, ask me about doing the sculpture? And she said, oh, I just had a feeling. So that was kind of a thrill.
All right. Thank you for that. People want to know, where can we purchase your art?
So of course, the Crane Foundation. Now, they've had a really good selection of all the crane images that I have. Right now, of course, you know, it's closed. And Rose has, you have to visit the crane shop online. She's got a really beautiful presence on web. Not all the images are online right now. If you want to check into anything, you can go to my website. It's russellworks.com. Or if you just search for Kim Russell Bird Artist, you know, you get to me pretty easily. And if you see anything there that's connected with cranes, we'll either make sure that Rose has it for the shop, or we will work out, I will donate a portion of the purchase to the Crane Foundation. And if you go to my website, you'll see I do a lot of other birds too, but cranes are still my favorite.
Well, Kim, thank you so much for your ongoing support of the International Crane Foundation. We are just thrilled that you are partnering with us. Another question, do you create other animals and other mediums?
No, wood was my main medium, which I still work in, and then the drawings. And you can see everything I've done, actually, from the start was all nature-related. Birds, animals, plants. I haven't really done depicted humans for many years. And those are pretty much the mediums I work in. And it would be the wood and the drawing and paint. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
All right. Thank you. One of our viewers today is wondering if you've ever had the spiritual journey to Rose Sanctuary and the Platte River in Nebraska?
I have. Yes, I have twice. And it is really amazing. And believe it or not, the staging here in Spring Green has become so important that there are times around, like right now, around 4:30 at night, the strings of cranes start coming in to go to the river for the night. And it's very reminiscent of my experience at the Platte River, especially when you're just outside of the river and at the farmer's fields, and they start rising from the farmer's fields and heading to the Platte. But yeah, that's a trip anyone, you can actually do it from here. You could go and do it overnight. It's something everybody should do.
Absolutely. And you can take that trip with George. So check that out on our website, savingcranes.org. One final question. How can I support, how can our participants today support the International Crane Foundation?
Well, same way I do with my association. My association is through the gift shop. I have it a little more intimately because through the gift shop, I've gotten to know so many of the employees and interns and volunteers. And I have to tell you, they're just such wonderful people down to the person. But by buying through the gift shop, you're not only supporting the Crane Foundation and the artists and small businesses that supply them, but best thing is you get a beautiful little item for yourself. And if you become a member, you get a discount on every purchase. That's the Scott in me. Why do you think I'm a member?
Well, thank you so much, Kim. And Pamela, thank you for your assistance with the question and answer moderator. This webinar has then come to a close, and we would like to say thank you again to our From the Field sponsors. This project is funded by Jody K. Kingdon and Henry S. Kingdon, doctor and PhD, and a grant from Sauk County, UW Extension, Arts and Culture Committee, and the Wisconsin Arts Board with funds from the state of Wisconsin. To learn more about sponsoring one of our webinars, please contact Kate Fitzwilliams. And please do join us. We will have our next From the Field webinar on Thursday, December 3rd at 11 a.m. Central Time. And it is going to be a continuation of our Cranes and Community Virtual Art Series. We have a behind the scenes look at painting the new murals at the International Crane Foundation. We are going to be joined by painter and muralist Jay Jocham, and I will be assisting in facilitating that. That webinar will also be funded by Jody K. Kingdon and Henry S. Kingdon, and a grant from UW Extension Sauk County. So we're excited to have those of you who can join us and participate in that webinar here coming soon. And again, this presentation and our work is made possible by the support of people like you. And we thank you. And we want you to know we are a donor-supported organization. And one of the best ways you can help us continue our work around the globe is by becoming a member. We would ask that you please consider making a donation on our website. You can share our story. You can support our global efforts. Please visit the International Crane Foundation next year when we are reopening again for May of 2021, and also consider making a purchase in our online store. Kim Russell, thank you again so much for participating in our webinar series today. It was a delight to learn more about your journey and see all of the beautiful artwork that has inspired all of us and has inspired you to continue conservation for crane species around the globe. Thank you, Kim.
Thank you.